And any news of Kansen Chu? What's going on with Kansen? Okay. Kansen and Daisy will be here shortly. But, you know, we are getting together. The theme is obviously unity and community. And last year, we actually had a gathering which was more of a religious nature. You know, we had clergies from different faith, and we were talking about how exactly we could do unity in the community. And they were actually quoting the religious scriptures and from the Sikh religion, from the Muslim religion, you know, lots of different faiths. And we were talking about the convergence. And this year we said, let's change it around a little bit. And we said, let's put the politicians on the hot seat. So after, we'll get started pretty soon. And we'll get to hear from some of our local politicians in terms of, you know, what is the social barometer today? You know, what exactly is going on? How's it impacting each of us? What are they hearing? And what are their plans in terms of how they're looking to address that? So that's the theme today. And when I look at the shift that has happened, and I'm not gonna talk about why exactly or how exactly, but we do see a little bit of a shift happening in terms of seemingly there is a mandate to go out and wear your heart on your sleeves and express the way you want. And is that right or wrong? And it's causing a lot of ripples. You know, folks are a little unsure as to why that is happening or how that is happening and how should we even react when that is happening, right? So those are tough questions because we have never quite, we have been in that situation before. And so it's a little bit of change management that we all need to do, not only within our own selves, but also in our community. And also from a standpoint of our lawmakers, our legislative bodies, our state senators, you know, they are actually going about and making very specific, taking specific action. In fact, the very first day at the swearing-in, and we had a bunch of folks who were getting sworn in new in Sacramento. I was there on that day, and Senator Jim Bell was speaking on a very specific agenda, trying to change the agenda, trying to shift the agenda, trying to change that social barometer, the way it's been shifting. And so there were some very specific stats that was taken in Sacramento. And so what I'll do is, we'll invite our keynote speaker, Senator Jim Bell, to get us started. And let's give it up for Senator Jim Bell. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Councilmember Kumar. Thank you, everybody, for inviting me to come. You know, there's a lot of people that are real confused right now, right, about what's going on. It's confusing. Like, what is all this stuff? What's happening? What's happening out there? Why is it happening? Why are people thinking the way they're thinking? How should I respond? What should I do? What kind of action should I take? I think the first thing people should do, myself, if they want to get involved and they want to take some action, is first, you know, sort of take that deep breath, you know, and do a little reflection inside yourself and say what role you have in the community, what is your value system? What do you really strongly believe in? And I always about this time, and my wife and I are gonna do it, Pat, my wife, I've been married 33 years, we do this every year in December or January, and we're gonna do it again. We kind of find our special quiet place we go, and I think, meditation is important. So what we do is we go down to Big Sur, where cell phones don't work, and nobody can call me. We kind of loosen up and be quieter, and you know, we think about what our values are. And I think right now, what I hope people do is I hope people don't get too noisy right away, but get kind of quiet and think about their values. I think that's real important. Today I had this rally that I spoke at, and I articulated what's going on in Sacramento. I'm going to do that in a minute here, and I think there's a time for action right now. But I think first, I think people ought to think about their values and where they, what their beliefs are and what they truly feel inside and how they, their lives are actuating their values, how your life is actually about your values. And so when you're a legislator, you have to do that even more so. You have to set a tone, an example. You have to, I have a way of putting it, you have to show face, you have to show up and tell people. And for me, doing that means articulate your values. Like what is your basic core values that you have in your work that you do representing people? What is your core basic values? To me, it's about social justice. I look at the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of California. I swear, when I take office, I have to swear that I will follow the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of California. And it's about, you know, it says all those things, the liberty and justice for all, the constitutional provisions of equality, all the constitutional provisions. And you listen to what people are saying, and I don't think they understand the Constitution. They haven't really, it's funny, it's really funny. People haven't really read the Constitution of the United States. They haven't read the basic rights that are outlined in the Constitution of equality and justice and those things. And I think it's very important to read those things. And then after you read them, reflect on your own values and how you want to implement or how you believe this country, this state, this community should reflect those values. And to me, it's about, right now, it's important to speak out about equality for all, for justice for all, making sure that we don't accept as leaders any level of prejudice, discrimination, sexism, you know, religious discrimination, any kinds of discrimination towards people, because that goes against the values. That goes against the values that we want to have in the Constitution. So, for me, when I go on and I, you know, I'm casting 2,000 votes a year. I'm casting votes. Your city council members that are going to speak in a little while, they cast votes. Our new colleague who's going to speak in a little bit, he's going to cast as many votes as I do. Our new assemblyman who is going to speak in a little bit. But you have to have something that makes you decide which way to go. And to have those values is so important. So I look at the social justice as a driving force for my decision process. What is fair? Not to exclude people. It says liberty and justice. What's that next word? For all. For all, not for just some of us. So when I hear people talk about discrimination and various code, you know, they talk kind of the way they talk, you can tell they don't believe somebody is as good as they are in terms of the way they're treated. That's kind of code for discrimination. Our country has had a history of discrimination. Our country has also had people that have constantly fought against discrimination. Monday we're going to celebrate one of those people, one of the most important ones. It's the celebration of the life of Dr. Martin Luther King. We're going to celebrate his beliefs, and what he stood for, and what we're trying to do. So what we're doing in Sacramento is we're doing things, getting ready to make sure that if changes occur in the federal government, that it reflects our values. And so we are getting ready in a legal sense, and a political sense, and a legislative sense, to review legislation that doesn't allow discrimination against people, that doesn't allow people to be treated unfairly without, remember that word, due process? Due process. I'm going to end with a story. And when I have 9 brothers and sisters, okay? I grew up here in San Jose. My dad grew up in the hills above here. He was a Las Gatas High class of 41 graduate. You know, that my parents met at San Jose State, then they settled in the Cambrian area and had the 10 kids. Well, when I was about 14, we had a new oven put in our house. The oven was put in incorrectly and our house burned down. We didn't have a home, we were homeless. And part of that was being the second oldest, the child in the family. I had to maybe pick up the slack and work hard to pay my own way through school and pay my own way through high school, which I went to Bellarmine, and then pay my own way through San Jose State. And so I worked in the evenings, worked in the fields in agriculture. I actually worked in agriculture for 10 years. And I saw working in agriculture, something that affected me for the rest of my life. And it was that the blatant discrimination against immigrants that took place by various types of people and doing things like not paying them adequately, not cheating them out of their salaries and their work, their payments that were due for their work that they did. People say, oh, that doesn't happen now. It happened right here in Saratoga, right? It happened right here. Recently, right? Guy had a restaurant, paid people on a few cents an hour and put them in a box in the back of his house and let them live there. And they were immigrants and they were intimidated because of their immigration status. Now, just from the standpoint of that, I say that's morally wrong, that's legally wrong, and we have to step up as leaders, show face, and let people know consistently that we're going to do something about it. Because it's happening. It's happening, not just in agriculture, it's happening in Silicon Valley, it's happening in the restaurants, it's happening in the stores. We have labor, theft. We have people that are brought in undocumented and they're discriminated against and pretty much blackmailed to work at a very small wage because of their status. And I can't stand it. I won't stand for it. I'm going to work every day to fight that, because that's against the values that I have. It's against my moral beliefs, my religious beliefs. It's against what I swore to uphold, liberty and justice for all. I didn't say, oh, these people, it's okay not to pay them because they're coming into the country illegally, or whatever word you want to use. They're here. they're here, they have families, they have children. We don't discriminate against them. We don't cheat them. We don't steal from them. We don't not give them health care. We don't let them starve on the streets. It's against our country's values, our personal values. So I learned that when I worked in the fields and I saw this horrible stuff, where people would come to try to get paid on Friday, and the labor contractor would have the sheriff come out, and they'd yell, "Oh, here's the immigration, he's gonna get you," and everybody would run away, and they cheat the people out of their money. So we can't stand it, we can't put up with it. We have to have leaders that stand up when people say, "That's not what we're gonna do." That's what, and we have to stand up for our beliefs. We're here to celebrate this year a major celebration in just a couple days with Martin Luther King and what he believed in, what he went to prison for. And I think sometimes people ought to read his speeches and listen to his speeches. It's much more fun to listen to his speeches, isn't it? Because he was so good at giving speeches, much better than me. But if you can read his speeches, and I especially want the young people to do this, read his speeches. It just has his words are some of the most beautiful words that will touch your heart that you can imagine. And let's have, when they say unity, that's what being a country is all about, unifying ourselves and being part of this world, being part of this country, and setting an example. That's what you should expect your elected officials, your leaders that you select, to do. And we shall not step back, we shall not fail. So thank you very much. I appreciate your time. And I want you to be unified and keep up the good work that everybody's doing. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Bell, for joining us and for your talk today. And so the next segment, what we'll do is, so here is the agenda for today. So we have a few panelists, locally elected leaders, like to invite them on stage. And we'll run through a panel discussion, get their viewpoints, insights, and what exactly they are working on to address this change of climate. So we'll get to hear their viewpoints. And then right around 3:30, a little after 3:30, we'll get started with our Unity Speech contestant. We have a few young kids of our community that have signed up all the way from like Pleasanton, San Ramon, through right here in Silicon Valley. So we'll put them on stage and we'll put them on the hot seat and see what they have to say. But the theme is about sharing an idea for unity, you know, what exactly we can be doing. Perhaps it's for each of us, perhaps it's for our locally elected leaders, perhaps it's for, who knows, but they'll come up with their different ideas and they'll be sharing here on stage. And we have about a few judges that'll be sitting up here and reading, and we'll be giving our prizes at the end. So that's the agenda for today. And I would like to start off, you know, obviously this is, Monday is Martin Luther King Day, and Senator Bell was talking about it in terms of having to continue the fight for equality, for justice. And I would like to reference a particular quote. And here is Martin Luther King. The ultimate measure of a man is not where he stands in a moment of comfort and convenience, but where he stands at times of challenge and controversy. Faith is taking the first step even when you don't see the whole staircase. So basically, it's not very easy. I mean, Martin Luther King, he gave up his life fighting the good fight. And for us to take that hard stance or even express an outrage, it's not the most easy situation for us to be dealing with. But it's important for us to do that. And so what we'll do is we'll continue this conversation with our panelists. And with that, I would like to invite a newly elected Assemblymember, Ash Kalra. And Ash has been here many times in Saratoga, but for the first time ever as an assembly member. So let's give it up for Ash Kamal. And Kansen Chu is on his way, so he's held up in traffic, but assembly member Kansen Chu will be here, so we'll save the spot for him. And then we have council member Howard Miller from Saratoga, two-time former mayor. And he's our local lad here, and we'll get to hear from him. And then we also have Councilmember Chappie Jones from San Jose. And it's kind of interesting, this is the very first time he's been here at the community center, even though he lives 5 minutes away. So this is a big day for us, the fact that we have Chappie here. And then we have, all the way from Modesto, we have Vice Mayor of Modesto, Manny Grewal. Okay, so what we'll do is we'll have, we'll get going with this panel discussion, and we have a few questions that we'll run through and have a conversation. It's a very informal discussion, conversation, expressing some ideas and also talking about agendas in terms of what exactly are they working on to address. And so firstly, I would love to have them start by sharing a little bit their thoughts on this particular topic. You know, what exactly are they seeing, observing, and some of their ideas in terms of how we could, each of us can address that. So we'll get going with that aspect of the conversation. We'll start with Ash.
Thank you. It's great to be back in Saratoga and talking about a really important issue. And you know, this is one of many events I know that we have here in Saratoga, but I really appreciate the fact that the dialogue is centered around what I think a lot of us are feeling. As Senator Bell was talking about, the tension, the uncomfortable feeling that a lot of us have. And I actually just came from the same rally that Senator Bell was speaking at in downtown San Jose, Immigration Rights Day of Action. And it's one of many rallies and marches that we're hearing about. There's the Women's March coming up next week. There are a number of different actions being taken, which is not exactly the ideal way you want a new president to come into power. You'd like to have some sense of unity. Now, there's never unity. There's never uniform unity. We have two major political parties, and every time there's a transfer of power to a new president, there's always going to be the winners and the losers, so to speak, in a political framework. But the problem that I see is that our politics have really become infected, I think, with such powerful interest groups and this whole winner or loser mentality, even within the parties themselves and with elected officials themselves, that it's their goal to win a position or for a party to win power. And what ends up happening is that the manner in which that's done is by division, by creating groups, by creating division amongst the community, really. And I think we've seen a lot of that over many, many years. We've seen that happen time and again. But I think this election cycle in particular, it was exacerbated. And I think because there are different ways to unite people, right? We have Dr. King, someone who united through such a positive message of love and peace and a true sense of community, of unity. And then you have, you know, those that will use fear of others, fear of their financial instability, fear of losing control, whatever it might be, but using fear, which is in many ways a much easier way to motivate through fear and through distance and through division, than unity is. It takes a lot more work. What Dr. King did took a lot more work than someone that would just, hey, let's go pick up a bunch of guns and start, you know, just start fighting. Right, it's much harder to do it through love. And you know, it's always, I think that, and I hope that we see, and we're starting to see people talk much more about doing things in a loving way. I think oftentimes the way in our society, when we think about love, you know, you're a lover or a fighter. You think of love as somehow being a weak emotion. And I think we have to, as a community, change our dialogue and the way that we talk about empowerment and movement building. And one of the ways we do that is the way we talk about love and how love is an incredibly powerful weapon for positive change. And that is what I saw today, the rally certainly, many different groups from that represent our community. But ultimately, you know, you have to love your enemy, and you have to do that in a genuine way, which means no matter what the conditions are that are causing tension or frustration or anger or even, you know, of pain and suffering, in order for us to combat that, we have to do it with a unifying sense of love, in a manner in which we're building up people, we're building up our immigrant community, we're building up women, we're building up folks that right now are really scared because of not just things that our president-elect have said, but promises that have been made, appointments that have been made, actions that are already being taken to take away health care, for example, from folks that are literally worried about whether they're going to be able to take care and protect and care for their own loved ones. And these are real things that are happening. And as the state assembly member, as Senator Bell said, we see this as a really important obligation for us to protect our people, protect our community. And the Senate and the Assembly, there are already a number of bills and bill proposals and just really constructive dialogue in preparation for what might be coming in a week and beyond. One of the first bills that the first bill that I proposed was to protect our undocumented students at all of our public colleges and universities. Because the first thing we want to make sure is that people aren't living in fear, that people feel that that they're together with the community. And to create unity, you have to first create a sense of peace. And if people don't feel protected, if they're scared, if they go back to living in the shadows, that's the exact opposite of what we're trying to accomplish in the Bay Area, what we're trying to accomplish in California. So no matter what comes our way from around the world, around the nation, we only have control over ourselves. So the easy work, in my opinion, is when we talk. And talking is important, being present is important, but it's the action. So coming together like this is important. Talking about it, coming unified like this is important. But this is not the hard work. The hard work is what we do when we go back to our daily lives, to be holding people accountable. If we see folks using rhetoric or demeaning someone or bullying someone, what do we do then? Do we put ourselves at risk? Do we put ourselves in an uncomfortable situation? And those are the questions I think we're gonna have to start asking ourselves more and more. And when we all start doing that in unison, that's the kind of unity that I believe we'll be able to rebuild the community, you know, through love. And that's how you fight back some of the sentiment I think a lot of us are feeling right now, the uncertainty that we're feeling in our nation.
Thank you, Harsh. Question for you, Harsh. In terms of your district office, you know, are there any specific agenda items that you've crafted this year to help address that?
So one of the things that we really want to do through the district office, of course, you know, Senator Bell and I made reference to what's going to be happening in Sacramento, and of course, that's policy, that's legislation on a broader sense to protect or to serve the entire, all the residents of the state. At the local level, it's really important for me to have my staff and me very present and available, and one way we're going to do that is working with Senator Bell. And oh, by the way, since the Senator left, I'll mention next Saturday morning we have a Cash for College event that Senator Bell and I are doing together. I'll get the information to Rishi so he can distribute it. But the bottom line is, you know, is making sure that we don't just stay in our offices, right? That we have our district office, but our goal is to really get out into the community, into the neighborhoods, into the schools, and hear the concerns, hear the fears, hear the issues that are out there, and then be able to address it in a very meaningful way. I think that that's something that we haven't seen a lot of from the district. I think we're going to see a lot more proactive service. I think especially with Senator Bell covering the same area I do, there's a really great opportunity for partnership. So we're still putting together our agenda for the year, but if you live in the district, just so you know, I represent District Assembly, District 27. Downtown, it's about half of San Jose, downtown San Jose to East San Jose, Silver Creek, Evergreen neighborhoods, down to South San Jose, Vista Park, and the areas where I live. And so, but I'm willing to partner. I'm here in Saratoga for a reason, because what we do doesn't stay within our borders. Those are all political borders. Ultimately, it's up to us to really build bridges in every way possible, including with our local electeds from around the area and around the state.
Thanks, Arsh. Councilmember Habibullah.
I know I should have said a Nazi, because who wants to follow Ashi's tennis?
So figure it out.
You know, I take more of a historical pinning and move forward. I'm part American Indian, you would never know it because it's that less than 1.5% Choctaw from Mississippi. And one of my good friends from middle school, we found out pretty early on that he was part Choctaw too. And we fought for a couple of years because he said Choctaw from Oklahoma. And our father, I sat down with my dad, I said, Dad, what's the deal? He goes, you are a pre-March of Tears Choctaw. And Dave is a post-March of Tears Choctaw. For the little kids, if you've never read this part of American history, in a general sense, the American government, the establishment, decided that the Indians were in places that were more important to the nation than those people, so they picked them up and moved them. And we had a national history in the early 1800s of moving the Indians anytime we thought they were someplace where we wanted their land. And my family was caught up in that. My mother was a German-American. Well, she was half German and half Italian, though in World War II it didn't really help. And she was actually issued an ID in New York City, as were all of the German-Americans. They didn't do anything with those IDs, but here in California, the Japanese-Americans were issued IDs and ultimately interned, be it the Central Valley or one of my good friends, George, his family was moved to Idaho. And when my daughter was 12, we drove to Idaho to visit the internment camp. I figured it had to be a big giant national monument because it's important for people to remember the history. Let's just say we spent 20 minutes there at the largest internment camp in Idaho, and we saw one other car in 20 minutes. And there's one plaque of a picture of the facility and a little bit of the history. And so I think that it's really important that we understand our history. And we understand where well-meaning people, people who were elected to the Congress and the Senate in 1940, 1930s, they were well-meaning, respectable people, but yet they fell prey to an argument that said that it was okay to take American citizens, deprive them of their freedom and of their property, and relocate them. And it's a history in the United States. It's a big fear of mine. You see my pin, I put it on the first day I heard about the pins. And what's funny with me with elected officials, I get a lot of elected officials say, oh, I have my pin too at home. And I don't think it behooves us to keep our pins at home. I think that we need to be very public about it. So how many here people have heard of Hakone Gardens here in Saratoga? You know, it's the oldest continuously operating Japanese garden in the Western Hemisphere. And it was easy to get that title because all the other Japanese gardens shut down during World War II. And in fact, our garden was operating in World War II, but the primary gardener was Japanese American, and he and his family was interned. And his personal possessions and belongings and the equivalent of the family Bibles and historical stuff was all burned. And he was interned. But Tilden, the founder of Tilden Park, Major Tilden, who was also the owner of Hakone, he stayed in touch with his gardener, even though he was in an internment camp. And as soon as they were released, he moved them back and he gave them his job back, which went for another two decades. It's an interesting thing because I have the utmost respect for Major Tilden. He wasn't in a position to change the political system. He could only support one family. And if that's what it means we each have to do is to help one family or one person or one small segment of community, that's our obligation as citizens. Now here within Saratoga, a little bit of, we were celebrating the 100th anniversary of Hakone, and you will hear about our gardener and the actions of Major Tilden for this year. Within our city, we have a ministerial association, and it's all the clergy from all the churches. We meet. A lot of times it's about what are we going to do for the holiday celebration or what are we going to do for a community project. This year the project really is building unity, and they've launched a program of what they're calling living room discussions. And they're training their clergy and they're training the members of their congregations to all be able to sit down and have discussions of people with vastly differing ideas. We may differ about whether we should build a wall. We may differ about various aspects of healthcare and how to best provide it. But we should be able to discuss it. We should be able to debate it. And we should be able to find places where we agree and find places where we disagree. And so that's going on within our community. And I'll make two comments about Washington. My cousin, he and his wife, he was chief of staff for congressman, and she worked for the president. She was the deputy of legislative affairs, so it was her job to pass Obamacare. So I have the picture of her waiting for the vote with the president in her office. That's where they heard the first vote on Obamacare, was her office. They're a little tired of American politics, and they both retired in June, and they moved to South Africa. So that's political commentary on what's going on in Washington. My personal commentary, my advice to Anna Eshoo, who I know pretty well, was for the party that's in power, it's now put up or shut up time. It's easy to have repealed Obamacare 65 times knowing that the president was not going to sign it. It is hard to say we have a better answer for healthcare for American citizens and put that into legislation. And that is what we're seeing right now, the battle that's going on in Washington. There's still the rhetoric of let's repeal it, repeal, repeal, repeal. And you're seeing some people now are saying, yes, we do want to repeal it, but we need to do something better. And so this is actually a healthy part of the process. Let's get out of the rhetoric phase. Let's get out of the it's bad, repeal it, knowing it's not going to be repealed. And they have to move to a phase where it's a, we have promised to do something better. For me, let's see it. Put up or shut up. And we as American citizens will watch this very closely. Not just healthcare, not just immigration, not just trade policy. There is a whole set of things that we are going to watch closely. And either America is going to move forward and it is going to be a better system, or it's not. And if it's not, we will all show up in 2 years and we will cast better votes. That's the way it works in America. I know that it's painful. I know it's disheartening sometimes, and it's a little bit unsettling at these points of transition. But we've survived for 200 plus years at this system, and we're going to survive the next 4 years. I promise you, it may not be pretty, and we may get a few more people off of their couches and out to the polling places, but we're going to get through this one way or the other.
Are you absolutely sure?
I'm absolutely sure. It's a weird thing. Each of us have been to Washington in our official capacities and stuff. I have been to Washington as a family member, as a friend, and sat with people who are on the inside of the inside. And I have an immutable belief that this country is the strongest country in the world, and that our system is not the prettiest looking system in the world, not the most noble looking system in the world, not the most polite system in the world, but it is the best political system in the world, and I'm proud of what we're going to be able to do. Hold on to your seats, it's going to be an interesting couple of years, but we will get through this, and one way or another, we are going to be a better nation.
Thank you, Howard. I did have a question because you touched upon Hakone, you took the time to talk a little bit about Saratoga. And Senator Beal, I think we all heard him, and he was actually talking about an incident that happened here in Saratoga, which was, in quotes, indentured labor. We basically found forced labor happening in Saratoga last year.
It was before that, because unfortunately I was the mayor at that time.
Oh. 2 years back.
Let me make some commentary about that.
But the question was, for Howard, that happened like just 2 years ago. Now, what are we going to do to prevent something like that happening again? What are some thoughts that we can all be talking about to ensure that it doesn't get repeated?
If you're a Saratogan and you read news that's bad in the paper, there's a little bit of you that's slightly embarrassed. Wait a minute, we live in Saratoga, how could this happen?
It is.
Imagine if you're the mayor and you get this early notice from the city manager that this is going on. I mean, I could see it being San Jose, but Saratoga, right?
I was surrounded by San Jose there.
Yeah, so there was, and I've known all these guys, so this is good. It was interesting. I was hugely embarrassed. That was my very first reaction. how could this possibly be in our city? We're a disgrace. And then the next thing that came to me was anger. I was mad. I was really mad. How could these people do this in my city? And then it shifted to me as the mayor. How could I let this happen? And I'm thinking all these crazy thoughts, like I'm going to every business next week. I want to make sure everybody's good. And I'm like, wait a minute, that's not right either. Where I ultimately landed at the end of the day is I wrote a letter to Lori Smith, who was our sheriff. And I expressed undying appreciation and gratitude for her to go after the lawbreakers, no matter where they are, no matter what the border is, and not assume, oh, it's Saratoga, it couldn't be happening there, and just put the complaint on the back burner. And I was actually very proud that the sheriff's office was willing to pull back the veil on our city, because this issue of human exploitation is happening in every city. It's not a San Jose issue. I'm not really picking on you guys. Okay, Chappie, yes. No, this is happening every place. And it's our restaurants, there are gardeners, there are day laborers, there's a lot of places where this is going on within our community, and it knows no borders. And we each need to be vigilant. And again, the sheriff's office does have a task force. They do investigate these complaints. And it's become incumbent upon us to really make sure that we'll say this looks wrong. They'll investigate it, they'll sort it out. But it's only gonna happen, it will continue to happen if we let it continue to happen. And it only gets solved if enough people stand up and say, no, this is wrong and we're not gonna let it happen. We are all, depending on your faith, we are all children of God. We are all the same. And we need to remember that. And it is not fair because of your immigration, the color of your skin, the language that you speak, the learning disabilities or birth defects that you have, that you can somehow be treated unfairly. And we just need to be mindful of that. It is easy. You touched on it, Ash. It is easy to use fear is a way to promote your agenda. It is hard to use a vision of a great future as a way to promote your agenda. One is faster, one is more expedient, and as the nation has become a little bit more cynical with the banking collapse and some other economic problems, it's very easy to evoke fear, and it's even harder to invoke a vision of a better nation and a better Saratoga and a better Silicon Valley. And so we have to redouble our efforts to put forth a better vision. And as for human exploitation, there have been other arrests within our city. And it will continue. It will continue until every person stands up and says no more.
Thank you, Howard. And I didn't want to welcome Kansen Chu, Assemblymember Kansen Chu, to a big round of applause. Kansen was stuck in a previous engagement and then the traffic and all that. So Daisy also. Daisy, welcome. Thank you for coming to Saratoga. Better than that for sure. And we'll continue with Chappie. You know, Chappie is council member from San Jose. And what we're talking about is basically some ideas in terms of what our elected officials are thinking about unity in the community and the social barometer, what is their sense, and some very specific ideas and thoughts that they have that they are currently working on to address that. And we'll continue going down that path. We'll have Chappie followed by Manny and then Kansen. And let's go with Chappie.
All right, well, first of all, it's tough going after Osh and then Howard, so I got a really high hill to climb. Just like Howard, I also look at this from a historical context. And I'll give you a couple of personal stories in terms of what that means to me. My great-great uncle was an African-American who was very proud. He dressed really well. He had a nice horse that he rode around the countryside in Florida. Well, he was so proud and full of so much of himself, I guess, that people didn't like that. And so one day they found him with his throat cut, tied to his horse in the fields. And the reason why his throat was cut and he was killed was because there were people in the community who felt that he was just too proud. He had too much pride in himself. I also heard stories from my mother about one night when they were at home in Florida, and a member of law enforcement actually knocked on their door and told them, you know, you better stay in the house because we're going to lynch somebody tonight. And so, obviously, you know, they stayed in the house, and sure enough, lynching happened that night. I also think about the context of my family when we, you know, my parents had already moved out to California, but we were traveling, visiting relatives in Florida, and we were driving back through the South, and remembering that we couldn't stop to use the restroom, and we had to use a Folgers coffee can to use the restroom going through the South. So I think about those stories, and when we talk about the internment camps, and we talk about how, you know, America's had a history of vilifying immigrants, whether they were German immigrants or Italian immigrants or Chinese immigrants or Japanese immigrants or Muslims. I mean, there's been a history in America of that. But I'm also very hopeful because of what I've seen in being a student of history and what has happened in the past and looking at where we are now, with all the problems that we have now, with all the issues that are going on in Washington, and the past election, and the rancor that we see, if you look at it in a historical context, we as America have been here before, and it's actually been worse. Things are better now. They're not anywhere near where we want to be, but I'm very hopeful that we're heading in the right direction. As far as solutions, I'd like to ask each and every one of you, and because you're here today for this event, everybody here already gets it from an intellectual level, but I'd like to ask each and every one of you to look into your heart and really do some self-reflection in terms of what biases and prejudices do I have that I need to address? And I can guarantee you, each and every one of you that I'm looking at right now has biases and prejudices. And I can even give you a specific example in terms of my own life. My wife's nephew has a daughter who brought home a young man, an African-American man, to a family event. And he had a gold tooth, he had tattoos all up and down his body and his neck, he has pants hanging all down. And so I immediately had a reaction of, okay, this is a, you know, thug, you know, someone who's, you know, riffraff, someone I wouldn't want my daughter to come home with. And then during the afternoon, I had an opportunity actually to talk to him and engage in conversation with him. And he was so sharp, so articulate, so thoughtful, so, you know, so intelligent, that I even had, and this is my own people, I even had that reaction of, this is not, I had a bias when I saw him, and this is not what I expected to encounter. And we have that in our community, whether you're Asian, white, African-American, Latino, there is that tension that's going on. My district is in the West Side. I live west of Lawrence Expressway, and I can tell you that there's tension going on right now between the Asian community, the white community, that, you know, it's not overt, but it's there. The Wall Street Journal in 2006 wrote an article called White Flight from Cupertino. And I keep that article with me to this day because it's a classic example of where we live in a bubble and we think that, you know, it's the Bay Area, it's San Jose, it's, you know, the West Valley, that we're very liberal, very progressive, but oftentimes we do not recognize our own biases and prejudices. So my first ask of you is to be reflective in terms of what biases and prejudices that you have. And then my second ask is to reach out to someone that's different than you are, whether they're more conservative than you or a different race, nationality, or religion, and get to know that person for that group on a personal level. Get out of your bubble. And from a policy standpoint, I can guarantee you that, you know, in working with members of the council like Osh and other members of the council, that is very progressive in terms of moving forward with an agenda that's very inclusive, that's recognizing the value of all residents of San Jose. We've already initiated several initiatives to make sure that that message is reinforced, and we're going to continue to do that. But a lot of it is on an individual, one-on-one, personal level of each one of you reaching out to another person and connecting on us on an individual level, and let them see what's in your heart and what's in your mind, and see what's in their heart and in their mind. And I think that's where you're going to see change happen. So again, I am very, very hopeful of the future. And because it's, you know, Martin Luther King's birthday weekend, you know, I always look back at what he said, that the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. And we always have to remember that this is a long struggle, but it's going to happen. And one day, it might not be in our lifetime, but one day we will achieve that American dream. So thank you.
I think you touched upon a very, very important point, which is all of us are going through some sort of a prejudice, in our mind, and which is very true. You know, and in the corporate world, in the high tech world, in Silicon Valley, we have some sort of a training. It's called diversity training, and it actually brings to fore some of these issues, and basically gets us to start thinking and reconciling and also adapting, basically. So it actually is a pretty helpful type of training. Now, in terms of your district, you know, are you thinking about something, some sort of a seminar or bringing your community together to talk about this, right? Because many a time, we actually push it under the carpet, we really don't talk about it. It's there simmering, and then it takes an election to bring it out to the fore, right? So what else could you be doing as an elected leader of San Jose to address that?
I could be doing a lot more, for sure. To be honest with you, I really haven't tried to tackle that specific issue.
There are many issues with that.
No, I know. It is something that is very important. It is something that we should and will be working on. I've been on the council for 2 years, and based on, you know, my priorities and other things I've been working on, that's something that's definitely come up on the radar. And it's something that we're focused on to address in the coming year or so. But it's something that needs to be addressed, and we need to work on it.
Thank you.
All right, well, thank you so much. I appreciate the opportunity to come out here. When I left home, I was kind of seeing, you know, being from the different area of the state, if the same kind of feelings and sentiments are going to be here. And obviously, our area, we're in Central Valley, and the same sentiments that I'm hearing here are the ones that are being carried out there. And I didn't want to focus it on myself, but I know the council member here had said of a family experience. But myself, I had that experience last year, running for elected office for the first time, wearing a turban, you know, in a pretty conservative area of the state. And I had to analyze myself if that was something that I was willing to overcome. I had those prejudices about myself. Like, if I go up to somebody's door and ask for their vote, and there's a turban guy standing in front of them, and they're like, you know, what's gonna be that? What's gonna be the initial reaction? And, you know, first couple times I went walking, I had those reactions. So it was, man, did I make the right choice, or is this something that, you know, I should have thought about more? Because one of the first days I was walking, and I knock on the door and I say, hi, I'm Manny Grewal, and I'm running for city council. And the general goes, for Modesto? He said, yeah, that's why I'm here. I mean, if I was running for Islamabad, Pakistan, I wouldn't be here, right? but that's the prejudice, right? That's what you have to overcome. And for me, I had to sell myself on it. So then when I was able to sell myself and say, hey, I'm born and raised in Modesto. This community means a lot to me. My children are from this community. I'm raising my family here. My wife practices medicine here. I mean, we're doing good in the community. So you know, I should get over it. And that's where I felt the compassion comes in, right? Everybody talked, and you know, all the people that have preceded me are very respectful in their own manner and know a lot on the subject matter. But the compassion, right, is when we kind of push, look from a broad spectrum and see, you know, there are people that are socioeconomically different than everybody. Everybody's on that different socioeconomic ladder. But if you're on that ladder up here, how to look down and how to treat them equally. If you're privileged to, you know, my parents were first generation, so they came here and they were able, me and my brother were born and raised here in the country, and that we're very proud of that part. But we also have to look at the people that whose parents had to make other struggles and they're here on different circumstances, how we address those situations. I know the biggest thing after the election, and I want to, in the context of time, I want to finish up quick because I know there's other respected members that are going to talk. But after the election, my kids had befriended a person that was a dreamer. She was going to college at UC Merced, and she used to be at the library where my children got tutored. And they started a friendship. I mean, she was much older, but she would kind of talk with them in very cordial terms. And you know, kids, if you talk nicely to them and you know, give them a lollipop here and there, they'll become your friends for life. And that's how it was. But you know, after the election, my daughter, who's 9 years old, calls me up, and I was at an election night event. And she's, you know, we obviously see how things were trending, and she's like, "Dad, if this happens, does that mean Daisy's going to be deported?" And you know, that kind of hit me right there, you know, because a 9 year old child thinking things out that much. And I said, "No, honey, it doesn't work that way. You know, there's a lot of different things that, you know, have to take place. So, you know, I want you to know that Daisy's going to be here as long as good people in the legislature, like the assembly members, are here, and you just talk about the legislation you guys are going to put through." Those are the things that, you know, we have to have compassionate leaders about, that are going to overlook at those issues and see how we can address them in the most compassionate way. So whenever I think of unity, I always think of compassion, because compassion is very humbling for me, because sometimes I have to put myself on that litmus test, that am I being compassionate? Whether it's being an elected official or in my role as a business person, am I being compassionate to my employees? Am I being compassionate to my constituents? Am I being compassionate to my kids sometimes? They might not agree all the time that I'm being compassionate, but you know, I try to be as well. So unity for me, that's what it means. And in this time where we just went through the holiday season, where there's a lot of compassion, and obviously on Monday we're celebrating the life of a gentleman that was very compassionate throughout his entire life, I think we hold ourselves to that test of how compassionate are we. So I appreciate the opportunity, and really appreciate you putting this together, because more of these events will allow us to think more positively on how we can make a positive approach. So I'm very humbled to even be on the stage with these gentlemen. Thank you very much.
Many have a question. So when I look at Modesto, you know, you find there's a little bit of an economic disparity, the demographics. What are you hearing back from your constituents? Was there any cause of concern? And if there is so, what exactly has been done collectively by the council to address that?
So the council is obviously taking these considerations. I mean, we're meeting on a daily basis. I know next week I have a couple, three meetings just to address issues, because there's uncertainty. I mean, we're a very agricultural driven community, and there are people that work in that sector that feel, you know, what's going to happen? You know, what's the end game on this? And they want to hear from their elected officials, not just their council members, but their assembly members. Even our congressman, he's holding workshops because they want to know, like, what's the end game? What as elected officials are we doing? And again, the reassurance. I think that's the biggest. I think when you can reassure, I mean, whether it was my 9-year-old daughter or it's a constituent that's asking questions that directly affect their livelihood, their children, their spouses, you have to give them, you know, the opportunity first to listen to them, and secondly, the reassurance that, you know, all in all, there's people at the state level, at the federal level, that are looking out. I mean, my good friend Kamala Harris, she was out in Modesto, and, you know, when she came back, she was still running for election, and, you know, very compassionate, telling her, you know, regardless of the outcome of what happens federally, I'm going to be a representative of California. I'm going to speak on the behalf of Californians and provide that reassurance. And, you know, that's the biggest thing, I think, first. And then as policies get set forward, whether it's federally or state level, you know, making sure that the constituents understand them. I think that's the most important.
That's great. Thank you, Manny, for joining us. I know Manny has an event to attend. this planning meeting at 3:30. So I really appreciate you taking the time.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me. I really appreciate coming down to this. It was a nice scenic drive-in, so it was good. Got to do a lot of recollecting and different things. So I really appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Danny.
Well, thank you very much. First of all, I want to thank Rishi for organizing this event year after year. I was there last year as well. And thank you very much for taking the time out of a beautiful Saturday afternoon to be with all of us. My name is Kansen Chu. I represent the poor side of the Silicon Valley, the North San Jose area, Milpitas, Fremont, Newark, and Santa Clara. And so when we were talking about the bias, you know, we're talking about the ratio, we're talking about the sex, or orientation, you know, we also need to be mindful about the socioeconomic status of the artist community. I am a U.S. citizen by choice. I meant that because I am a first-generation immigrant. I came to the United States as a graduate student after I finished my bachelor degree in engineering back in Taiwan. And after I received my master's degree from Cal State Northridge, and I was hired into Silicon Valley by a small company called IBM. And I worked as an engineer over there for 18 years before my wife, Daisy, and I ventured into a Chinese restaurant business. And then from there, you know, I became a public servant. First run for the various school district, got elected twice. And then there was an opening in San Jose City Council. I put my names in and got elected three times, because the first time was a special election. I only got to serve in that capacity for the 18 months, and then I run for the two terms that I have. And I got an honor to serve with OSH for 6 years as a San Jose City Council member, and was elected to the Assembly 2014, the first term, and the 2016, and the second term. So it just gave me a great honor, and it's a very rewarding experience for a new immigrant to be able to serve the people of California and the country that I choose to become a citizen of. And I would like to tack into my good friend and previous colleague, Chappie Jones, as a comment. About, you know, self-reflective of, you know, do we have our bias, you know, of our own? I think that's a very, very good point. You know, do we look at people not just because they have tattoos, or do we look at people the same way if they speak the language with an accent? You know, when I came to the United States, I was very, very proud that I can speak two languages. One is my mother tongue, Mandarin Chinese, and second one was a machine language. I can talk to the computer, I can talk to the people that speak Mandarin, but I know that I have to pick up the English to be able to survive in this new founded land. And I got involved with the politics after both of my kids are growing up, and I realized this is the home to them. You know, I need to really help them to establish some root in the United States. You know, I'm a Chinese American, and many of you may know that the Chinese American is the last ethnic group that has the right to vote in the United States. It was during the World War II that they lifted the Chinese exclusion right to allow the Chinese to marry to a different race, and to allow the Chinese to cast their vote to participate in this democracy. So it is very, you know, close to my heart, and we make sure that we be able to continue working with more diverse and harmonic society. I want to share a little bit of my experience as a chairperson of an organization called OCA, Organization of Chinese American. It's a nationwide organization. We have about 47, 48 chapters throughout the United States. And every year we have a convention. And when I was the chair of the OCA Silicon Valley, we had a convention in San Francisco. One of the topics that was on the table is that's exactly what we're talking about here today. And during this a discussion, the people from the Silicon Valley brought up the fact to say, hey, we need to fight for the bigotry, and we need to fight the diversity, the bias, in our Chinese organized Chinese ethnic group in our community. And then there was one member from down south in Texas. You know, they said, what are you talking about? You guys are living in Silicon Valley, the most diverse area. And you're talking about being looked down, and you guys are talking about having bias and bigotry. You know, we don't have that. We don't have that in the small town Texas. Yeah, and we this Chinese American speak with a southern accent, so cute. So we put our heads together, and we finally realized that when we are the bigger of our community, I mean the ethnic community in the area, the more of the bias or bigotry we may be facing. Because you know, when you see a little tiger, you know, a puppy, you don't feel threatened. But when you see that the little tiger become a big one, you know, and then this is where you feel that the people are you threatened, being feel that they were being threatened by the size of your community, by the wealth that you have generated, and so on and so forth. So I guess it's very, very important, even in the Silicon Valley, that we have this kind of discussion and reflect on ourselves and try to figure out a way that we be able to, like Chappie says, reach out to people with a different religion, reach out to people that come from a different part of the world, and introduce your culture, your value to them, and also have the opportunity to understand their cultures and their values. This year, we are definitely bracing for whoever knows what may happen from the federal government. The state is really, we were spending money, we're spending time and effort to kind of a bracing for the worst. Like Chappie Jones, I'm hopeful. You know, this is a country again of my choice, and I love the system that we have been established for over 200 years. And I'm hopeful that it will not be changed with one administration. I know that there may be some backpedaling, and I can assure you that California is ready to fight against it. Earlier this week, I have introduced a bill, AB 158, which demand the Californians from Eureka down to San Diego to have a uniform, a standard way of reporting hate crimes. Many of you may not know that in different parts of the state, the hate crimes are reported differently, are prosecuted differently. So I want to make sure, and I'm very proud to say in Santa Clara County, we are definitely leading the way to have a very strict definition, a standard of the hate crime, and we prosecute the hate crime as is a hate crime. But there are some rural areas that they would just brush it underneath the carpet. And so the AB 158 will have the same standard, you know, throughout California. And I know that Ash would be co-authoring that bill with me, and then we'll put in the effort to put it through the both Assembly and the Senate, and hopefully we'll be able to sign into law by our governor, Jerry Brown. So with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions. I know.
Yes, thank you.
Benny is hurrying to leave the room. I'm very
deprived of your conversation.
So thank you again for giving me the opportunity to sit in with this very distinguished panel here. Thank
you. Good to have you, Kansen. And we'll wrap this panel pretty quick in 5 minutes. So I know Manny has to leave. But we'll run through my last question. And it's a wrap-up question, which is basically, you know, what is the, and we'll keep it, if we can keep it under 30 seconds to a minute, please stay there.
We'll let Manny go first.
Okay, yeah, that's right. Thank you. And, you know, if we can keep it to 30 seconds to a minute, I think that would be really good. But what is the call to action, you know, call to action for each of us, or perhaps from an elected leader standpoint, you know, what do you think is that one call to action that we should incorporate? You know, I like what Kansen is doing, the establishing a simple protocol, process, a framework to go out and report these hate crimes. I really recommend you to go out and Google today. You know, there is a national crime statistics that has been rolled out. This was in 1990, George H.W. Bush basically established an agency to go out and capture the reporting and establish metrics that is actually published online. So I really recommend you to go out and take a look. You will not see a dramatic increase year to year because, you know, it's just some of the changes are beginning to happen right now. So what we'll be telling is to actually look at the end of this year, but that statistical information is there. So I highly recommend you taking a look at that. But let's talk a little bit about the call to action. The one or two things that you would like us to be doing in the community.
Well, I would have really liked to start again on that side. I would have copied some of their answers. But anyhow, I mean, I always think of being change agents in your community and getting involved like this. That's whenever I get an opportunity to tell anybody, that's the way, because if you're that change agent, you're that catalyst that can gather that information. And everybody can't do it. I mean, we all have busy lives, we all have priorities, but being that change agent where you can be in touch with your local leaders, with your statewide leaders, and your federal leaders, and then, you know, again, giving that reaffirmation of things are going to get better, or things are getting better, or how things currently stand. I think that's the biggest thing. So, you know, I encourage all of you to continue to be those change agents. You coming and spending this Saturday afternoon obviously shows you want to be part of that process. Thank you very much.
Well, I think I'm going to hand the curve on this one because I already actually gave you your challenge, and that is to reach out to someone that's different than you. Socioeconomically, reach out and talk to the homeless person that you see on that corner, you know, when you drive by. Maybe take a minute and just talk to them. Someone from a different religion or different race or just someone that's a different sexuality. Just get to meet someone that you wouldn't normally talk to or interact with and find out what they're like on a human level. I was fortunate enough to go to a high school which was literally the United Nations. It was 1/4 African American, 1/4 white, 1/4 Asian, and 1/4 Latino. And we had every religion, you know, nationality. And one of the things that I discovered from my childhood and going to a school like that was that 90% of it were all the same. It's that 10% that's different. But that 90%, I guarantee you, we are all the same. In every group, you have people who are really nice, and you have people who aren't so nice. You have people who are really smart, and you have people who aren't so smart. And every group, every nationality that I've ever encountered has the same bell curve of people. And so it's just upon us to go out and get to know them on a human level.
Yeah, I'm just big on everybody being knowledgeable, vigilant, engaged in voting. You know, we have a pretty high voter turnout in Saratoga, but I can't say that that's true in the state or the nation. And I think that's sort of a linchpin If we don't like what's going on, we need to vote people in that will be doing what we think are the right things.
I would just say, you know, if you can't be a change agent, or you can't, you don't have the time, energy, or even the desire to be out in the forefront, we all have something we can do. We all have control over our own actions. So even if that means just within your own family, you know, having more loving and peaceful interactions, having conversations with your kids. And this, some kids, you know, will ask the questions and say things, but a lot of them won't, and they'll just keep it inside. So find ways to improve the conditions that are immediately around you, your home, where you work, your neighborhood, meet your neighbors. A lot of us don't know our neighbors. Go meet your neighbors, but find a way within whatever comfort level you have. Try to go outside your comfort level a little, but we all have control over how we act and how we behave in our own environment. And so I think this is a perfect opportunity now, especially with everything happening around us, to control what we do have under our own environment.
I have only 30 seconds.
Yes,
20 seconds. 20 seconds now, so it's difficult to, you know, when you give a microphone to an elected official, it is very, very difficult for them to express their thought in 30 seconds. But in this case, I would just say I detailed everything that has been said. But getting involved, you know, I see Sameena over there from CAIR, and the Muslim community has done at least a decent effort. I don't know, there's still a long ways to go of opening up their mosque and inviting, you know, interfaith gatherings. And I think this is something that I like to see more in my district. And I'm organizing an interfaith breakfast. So we bring up leaders from all different ethnicity, all different faith groups to break bread together and to promote a mutual understanding. Thank you.
Phenomenal leaders of Silicon Valley, and it was good to have all of them join us and express their insights. Please, big round of applause to all of them.
And you're all ready to stay and watch some of the contestants, our Unity speeches. And Manny, I know you had a busy day, so thank you for making all the way from Desk.
Thank you for putting this together. Very
good. Super. And with this, we'll move on to the next phase. And the next phase is we would like to invite the judges up here on the first row. And I would like to invite Sameena Usman from CAIR, Deepa Sharma. Deepa Sharma has been a political campaign manager, very engaged. Sameena Usman is from the CAIR organization, very visible in the Bay Area. And in fact, Deepa Sharma used to be part of Jim Bell's office in a previous lifetime. And she is actually a practicing attorney now. So it's great to have Deepa join us. I would also like to invite Trustee Sophia. Sophia Kaur, come on, join us. Rita, join us. Rita ran a pretty good campaign as a school board trustee. And she fell just a little bit short, but she's very, very engaged in our community on the school side, and doing what it takes to make our schools better. I would also like to invite Sharan Kaur, trustee from Union City, born and raised in Union City, and she went to school there, and now she's a trustee there. So that's a great story playing out. I would also like to invite Cynthia Miller. Cynthia here? Cynthia, trustee from the Saratoga Union School District. So we have two trustees from the Saratoga Union School District today. Cynthia Miller, and then we have Trami Cron, and she is a commissioner from the city of San Jose. So great to have Trami. And then last but not the least, we have Councilmember Howard Miller, who's staying back to judge. He loves speeches, he loves giving speeches, he loves grading speeches as well. So we have Howard staying back. And then let me not forget, Parmeet Chaddha from the high-tech world. He's rolled out startups, sold startups, you know, he's living the Silicon Valley dream. And good to have. So let's give it up for all these judges here today. Let's give it up for them. Yes. going to run through this. So real quick for the judges, I'm going to run through. You're basically, there are five key criteria in terms of how you're going to grade these contestants. They are going to give out a speech, which is a Unity speech, and they have some very specific ideas they are going to share. And we had provided them some sort of directions in terms of how they're going to prepare their speech. And the different components of grading is the presentation style, the overall presentation style, you know, how whatever appeals to you, does not appeal to you, based upon that, on a scale of 10. So 5 points, 7 points, 10 points. The points for reference to the elected leaders panel, the number two criteria from the rubric. Basically, you know, they were here listening to the elected leaders, and are they specifically picking up anything that they heard from today as part of their speech? So that's something else that you'll be looking out for. Uniqueness of idea, you know, that's very simple. Clarity of idea in terms of how their speech is, the clarity, and use of specific facts and statistics. So those are five simple criteria in terms of the evaluation. Any questions from the judges? I really appreciate the judges taking the time today and joining us today. So thank you again. And with that, with that, we will like to invite our contestant, our first student to come up here and speak. And I have no idea who the person is. So I'm gonna hand it off to my wife, Seema, and she's gonna call out.
Okay, so I'm not sure if this person is over here, but the first in the list is Advik Golubunta. No show? Okay. Swarna, is Swarna here? Okay, I think the first three are not here. So, Agrima. Okay, so we'll go with Preetal Deshpande. I know Preetal is here. Yeah, first name is P-R-E-E-T-A-L. Preetal?
Hello, my name is Preetal Deshpande, and today I'll be talking about my speech for Unity in the Community. There are many religions with different cultures around the whole entire world. Every religion and culture is unique in their own ways. There are cultural events that are for everyone. Those cultural events show how their culture and religion was like. Well, that is one example, but there are many more. One which is unique is storytelling. Storytelling is fun for all ages, to kids, to adults. The kids are the future of our own community. The stories are from countries and religions from all over the world. The kids should understand that we are all the same, even though the people are from different places are all over the world, but we still are humans. Even though storytelling is used for entertainment, it also can be used for unity among us all. Thank you.
Thank you, Preetal. Our next contestant is Vidya. Is Vidya here? Okay. The next one is Samira. Samira is over here. Her first name is spelled as S-A-M-A-I-R-A.
My name is Myra. I'm an 8-year-old third grader from Santa Clara. With the recent happenings, some people think the future's gonna be dark. Well, I think you think about the future a lot. I believe the future's gonna be awesome. It has to be. It will be. I agree hate in America is dreadful. There have been 867 cases of hateful harassment just 10 days after the election. They've been everywhere, from schools to businesses like Walmart, from streets to mosques, from Uber drivers to college students. There's a nation's intolerance all over. In the face of hatred, apathy will be taken as acceptance. We must help. What can you do? Pick up the phone. Call your friends. Host a neighborhood meeting. Speak up in church or chapel. Sign a petition. Do your part to fight hate. Hate crime victims are especially lonely, alone, and helpless. If you're a victim, report every incident in detail and ask questions. If you learn about hate crime victims in your community, show support. Let them know you care. Do not attend a hate rally. Find other ways to let out your anger. For example, hold a unity rally or a parade. Try to draw media attention away from hate. Hate often begins at home. It grows out of divided communities. Communities in which people feel voiceless and powerless. Communities in which differences are the reason of fear instead of celebration. The best cure for hate is tolerant and united communities. Schools can offer tolerant and acceptance lessons. Change happens when we believe in each other and in ourselves. Change a little, and you can change a lot. Throw kindness around like confetti. Don't judge someone unless you walked a mile in their shoes. Also, don't steal their shoes. Borrow them, give it back, and then be friends. Make a ruckus for good. When life gives you lemons, don't post about it online. Make lemonade, drink it, and dance. Be the reason somebody dances this week. Sure, there are bad things in the world, but there's also you. Be kind, be bold, be awesome. Repeat, it's like shampoo, both your life. We are gonna change the future. Tomorrow will be better because of how awesome you can make today. Thank you.
Thank you, Samira. Next contestant is Divya Balaji. First name is spelled D-I-V-Y-A.
Hello, my name is Divya Balaji, and I will be talking about unity in the community. Unity in the community. Given the news headlines, peppered with hate crimes, racial discrimination, and violence, some people might say that the words unity and community don't even belong in one sentence together anymore. But how can you have community without unity? According to the New York Times, hate crimes have increased a whopping 6% in 2016 against minority groups. But there is hope. This nation faced a tragedy when a man filled with hate took 9 precious lives at a church in Charleston, South Carolina. His motto was to incite a racial war in America. However, the families of the victims did not let this deranged man claim victory. They stood tall and firm, together as a community, and even went as far as to pardon this undeserving man. As we fellow Americans saw this situation, we saw love, not hate. We saw forgiveness, not revenge. And we saw unity, not division. This is exactly what Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. meant when he said, "Love is the only force capable of turning an enemy into a friend." The panelist, Mr. Kalra, also said, "Love and peace are the only things that can create unity." When each member of a family loves and understands one another, that family thrives. When each family thrives, that community flourishes. When each community flourishes, the nation succeeds. America is the greatest nation on this planet, not because of its tallest buildings, most money, or because we have the best phones on the planet. It is because we do not let our fellow Americans feel less than we are, or to be bullied into believing that we don't belong here. Our country's motto is E Pluribus Unum, out of many, one. So let's stay true to that motto and bring unity to our community. Thank you.
Thank you, Divya. Our next contestant is Vikram Potluri. Our first name is V-I-K-R-A-M, Vikram.
Hello everyone who spent time out of their wonderful Saturday to come here. My name is Vikram Patluri, and I want to talk about unity in this community. During this year, I guess, there's been a lot of hate crimes, like when a man attacked a Muslim woman just because she was wearing a certain thing. This should not happen because everyone is equal on this earth. They're all human. One way we can stop all of this is to spread our love on social media. Everyone's on social media nowadays, so isn't that the best way to spread it? We can write happy comments on Facebook and YouTube and spread the love everywhere. Another way we can spread the love is to stop hate crimes by starting an event every year about unity and friendship. This would inspire lots of people and it would help against hate crimes, which are the worst thing on the planet, in my opinion. Thank you for coming.
Thank you, Vikram. Our next contestant is Vicky Thoram. Vicky is V-I-K-I.
Happy New Year 2017. I'm Vicky Torm from 3rd grade Blossom Hill School, Los Gatos. Today we're talking about unity and in community. Unity means sticking together, and community means the people around you. Amelie is my friend, and she's from Australia. And I went to Australia, and I went to hikes, and I met new people. And there I saw nature that helps you be a better, helps you be a better community. And I went to the library on rainy days with my friends. And there I read books with my friends that also helped me be a better community with my friends. And me and my friends and my family go to homeless shelter. And we give people food. Then we can be a better community with our people. Thank you.
Okay, our next contestant is Rohit Dugaraju. I'm not sure he's here. Rohit? No? Okay. Ajit Shamraj. Ajit is here. His first name is spelled A-J-I-T.
First of all, Happy New Year, everybody. I'm going to be talking about the hate in our community and what we can do to change it. The panel didn't really talk about it much, but I am. So there's a lot of hate in our community, but we need to change it. My solution would be to change people's mindsets, but that's a very hard thing to do. So we have to take it step by step. An example of this is when my friends used to use a word that was very insensitive to people who were mentally challenged, and I had a short conversation with them on why, like, I give them a talk on why you shouldn't say the word, and then now they don't say it as much, and but they still say it sometimes, so, but it's not as frequently used. So this shows that change can happen overnight, and just like how Assemblyman Ash said, you need to speak up. If you speak up and be vocal about things, you can create change. A way you can help the community is by making the flyers, websites, going online, spreading the word about hate and how it needs to be stopped. And like small drops make up the ocean. Like every small decision you make can make a change. Thank you.
Thank you, Ajit. Our next contestant is Ojo Somani. His first name is spelled O-J-A-S.
Hi, my name is Ojis, and today I'm going to talk about unity. So, United We Stand was written in the Liberty Song on July 1768. This quote shows unity is important because when a team comes together, they can succeed together. It will make it much easier to work efficiently and faster with others. I would like to share a story with you, which I really think shows the meaning of unity. So once there were three brothers, and they used to fight every day. They would fight on anything. The father of the three was really tired of them fighting. So he came up with a way to teach them about unity. He gathered the three brothers and gave them each a stick to break. The brother thought this was just a joke because it was really easy to break the sticks. Then the father took the broken sticks and tied them together with a rope. Then he said, "Now you have to break this." They tried and tried, but they could not break the stick. So then the father said that when the sticks are tied together, they cannot you cannot break this. But when they're divided, it's very easy to break. This story shows when you are united, you cannot be stopped and you can keep going. While when you are divided, it's the opposite. Unity is a very important thing when you are in a team. To help the problems in Silicon Valley, like racism, drug use, and killing, with unity can be possible. For example, we can abolish all this with unity by getting to know everybody, and even if they're a different race, treat everybody like you treat your friends, and lead them to the right path for achievement. Everybody thinks Silicon Valley is rich, and that is why we are a huge technological powerhouse. Well, the poor actually have more than us and have been helping us grow Silicon Valley. This is why we should be unified with everybody, even the poor. This is a story why satisfaction is richer than any comfort money gives. One day, the father of a wealthy family took his son to a trip with the express purpose of showing him how poor people live. They spent a couple of days and nights on the farm of what would be considered a very poor family. On the return of the trip, the father asked the son, "How was the trip?" The son responded, "It was great." The father asked the son, "Did you see how poor people live, and did you learn anything?" The son answered, "Yeah, I did, and I saw that we have one dog and they had four. We have a pool that reaches to the middle of our garden, and they have a creek that has no end. We have imported lanterns in our garden, and they have the whole horizon. We have a small piece of land to live on, and they have fields that go beyond our sight. We have servants who serve us, but they serve others. We buy our food, but they grow our food. And we have walls around our property to protect us, while they have friends to protect them." The boy's father was speechless. Then his son added, "Thanks, Dad, for showing me how poor we are." Unity is an important thing for Silicon Valley. If we interact with each other and work together, we can stop all the racist remarks, killing, and drug use. Thank you.
Okay, our next contestant is Iman Ahmad. First name is spelled E-M-A-N.
Hi, my name is Iman. I'm a freshman at Saratoga High, and through all my life, I've seen America go through a lot of discrimination and bigotry, and my family is Muslim, so we've had a lot of experience with this in places, especially like the airport, ever since 9/11. And it was mentioned that there are many different ways to unite each other, and I believe that one of these ways is to appreciate and acknowledge all the different cultures around the U.S. because the U.S. is a melting pot of different cultures. In my own school, we have people who are many different races. We have Asian, Hispanics, white people, and even people who are of more than two races. But as I look around my school, I don't see people divided by the color of their skin or their religion. I see people who group together based on common interests and other things like that. And I feel like in the community, if we find a way to display all the best parts of our culture or the best parts of all the groups of these people, it would be a good way to help everyone appreciate that we all have common interests. An example of this would be something like a food fair, because everyone loves food. So that would be a good way to bond. And it would people can start to see that we shouldn't be divided by the color of our skin, our faith, the language we speak, our sexuality, and that every group of people and every person has something good to offer. Thank you.
Okay, our next contestant is Ricky Thorum. First name is R-I-K-I.
Happy New Year of 2016. I'm Ricky Thorum from first grade, Blossom Hill School, Los Gatos. Today, talking about unity in community. Come to unity. Allendale, St. Bernard, present. Recently, there's been a president election. And there's been a lot of talking about wall building and at school, if people say something bad about me, I ignore or turn it into a good comment. My friend Timmy taught me two Russian words, chess, and I mean one German word and one Russian word, and babushka means grandma and chess means a bye. Recently, I traveled to Australia. I did a lot of hikes and I went to a lot of zoos with my mom's friend and my dad's friend. And hikes. And with my friend, I go to homeless shelters and we give food. Bye.
Good Okay, our last contestant for today is Vidushi Somani. Vidushi is spelled V-I-D-U-S-H-I.
I just wanted to clarify that I'm not a contestant. I'm just looking for attention. Okay. There's been a lot of speeches and a lot of things about unity and coming together and stuff like that and different races. But the problem is, in the Silicon Valley, there's actually no real diversity. Because the thing is that there's so many like Asians and Indians. If you go to like my school or to like any tech company, if you see even one Caucasian person, it's called diversity, which is not real diversity, okay? In different parts of the US, there's actual diversity where there's Latin people and European people and all different kinds of cultures. And so I just wanted to talk about some of the different cultures that there are and kind of like a little bit of history too. So there was a little bit of controversy a lot of controversy between the South of America and the North, right, in the past. And so a lot of that was like a lot of conflict and stuff like that. So they would fight over a lot of things. Like if you saw like a northerner and a southerner, like they would fight over the silliest things, like even a subway seat, okay? So if like a New Yorker came to a subway seat, they'd be like, "Hey, get out of my seat. This is my seat. Get out of here. I walked over here. This is my seat. Get out of it. Don't be so rude. I walked over here, I took the seat, and you taking my seat over here? Not cool." And then the southerner would probably say something like this: "Okay, forget the southern hospitality. I am not gonna help you, you are being so rude. This is my seat, and you cannot take this. We're gonna have a showdown." No, I'm kidding, they would never say that, that's weird. No, nobody would ever say showdown. And then, like US and Russia, like, so US also has conflicts with Russian people, right? So the US would, the US don't know how to pronounce like Russian names, and Russian people don't know how to pronounce American names. So they would say, "Oh, my name is Miss Korsansky." That's like a very pretty popular Russian name. Like an American person would probably say skunk. No, that's not it. If they said their name was Mr. Vladimir, that's a pretty common Russian name. American person would probably say how can a V and an L be next to each other? Vladimir? Something like that, right? And then Russian people can definitely not pronounce American names either. If somebody's name is Sophia, probably be like something like that. And Russian people are actually like really good at math, right? So if like a Russian person would teach like a math class, it would probably look something like this. Okay, today I'm going to teach some mathematics. Math is a very fun subject. It is the most fun in the world. Okay, so let's imagine that there is a horse, and the horse is going, and it fallen to a gutter. How many meters it fallen to the gutter? You have to calculate and check your answer. So, like, so somebody would raise their hand and probably be like, excuse me, what are you saying? Are you saying, like, a horse is going to a gator and getting eaten by a gator? Be like, no, I am saying that the horse is falling through the gather. Okay, so that would, like, be complete miscommunication. And then China and Singapore recently, they've been having some conflicts in the South Sea, right? And so Singaporeans, like, there's some, like, territorial conflict. And the Singaporeans would probably say, like, oh, this is so close to me. I can go so fast. If I can take the train and I can only play the $1 train and I have enough money left over to buy a red t-shirt. And then Chinese people would probably say something like this. No, you cannot take my land. This is my land. Tyler, get me a map. I will show you that you cannot take anything. And then there were some French and British conflicts too. Like, you know, the French and... Actually, you know, I've heard that the French and British are really good friends. No? They're not. They weren't. So a French person would go to, like, a British person and say, I love the English language, and Spanish is not so good, French is actually better language. And then the British people will probably say, oh, I love French people, they're so lovely, they're a wonderful group of people, I love their food. So there's all these different countries, they come together, and a bunch of different countries, and basically they shouldn't be fighting and they shouldn't be having all these conflicts, they should all come together, and I think that's what all these speeches were talking about. And this is a wonderful event. If you really liked it, then this was organized by Rishi Kumar and Mrs. Seema Kumar, and if you didn't like it, it was organized by me. And I was paid to say that, by the way.
Thank you.
Okay, so that was the end of our contestants, and many of them dropped out. Long weekend, they are taking off skiing, I guess, or some of them are trekking the fine weather we have today, but I think the contestants here deserve a big round of applause. So let's give it up for them. Let's give it up for each and every one of them. They took the time to prepare, they showed up, and they had some pretty interesting ideas. And I was actually a little afraid of the last one, because whenever Vidushi is on stage, I'm like standing at the back, because if you're sitting up front, then you get targeted, because she does stand up. So I was afraid of the judges today, you know, sitting out here in the front. But she kind of spared you today. So while we tabulate the results, I would love to invite the judges up on stage and have speak a little bit. Parmeet, join us. Just speak your mind, you know, in terms of what are you thinking in terms of unity in community and specific thoughts, ideas, and you don't have to speak, or you can talk about the contestants, totally your call. So Howard, let's start with Howard. I would like to invite all the, and Sameena, I would love to talk about CAIR and some of the activities that you are working on this year, because with all the anti-Muslim sentiments, you know, last year that was the focus, but as part of our Unity in Community Day, but would love to have Sameena also talk a little bit about that. Deepa, join us, everybody, come on. Sorry? Well, we're just going to be talking for like 30 seconds to a minute each, you know, and we'll run through this quickly. And then I would like to invite Monica Goyal to give out the prizes. You know, I think we are pretty much done. And I really appreciate all of you taking the time. I think a big round of applause for our judges here today. We'll start with that.
So it was great to see so many speakers. And I didn't know if we were going to turn the slips back, so I wrote my notes on them anyway. But here's the hint that I have for every speaker, which is, just relax, it's your story, and it's not really about the exact words you may have tried to memorize, it's really just tell your story, and that's what works best.
No, likewise, it was very interesting to hear young kids express ideas on a topic which is very weighty. It's top of mind for all of us, issues of race and equality and all the tension that is brewing around that, especially given the recent elections. So thank you for having the courage to express your ideas on the stage. It was quite frankly very insightful for somebody like myself as well. And Rishi, thanks for inviting all of us. Appreciate it.
I'd like to thank all the speakers today. I find it very inspiring to see young people who will come up and do something that can be very, very hard, getting in front of a crowd and conveying their ideas. And it just gives me a lot of hope for the future to see their bright, eager faces up here. So thanks very much.
Same sentiment for me. I'm so proud of you guys. I mean, you're starting so young, and I would not be able to do that 2 years ago. And I'm old. Okay, so I'm very proud of you guys. For me, I think that if we want to change the world, first we change ourselves, but secondly, within our own community. So I'm Vietnamese, and within my own communities, we have division. This group who came in 75, this group who came in the 90s, this group who just came. So we can't get along even within our own communities. So start there, that's quite easier. You have the same language, you have the same food, so start there. That's my thought for the day.
Hi, I'm truly impressed with all of the people who came and spoke. As I think everybody has reflected that it's not easy coming up and speaking with people who you don't know and to be able to convey the messages. But what I would say in terms of the theme of today's event is really try to get to know somebody who is not like yourself, somebody who has a completely different background, completely different upbringing, different socioeconomic level, and there's so much we can learn from each other. I know I tried to expose my kids, who are over there, to a lot of different events, a lot of different things, whether it be going to celebrate the Chinese New Year or to go and march in the May Day parade. You know, they've gone to many marches. They were in the march today as well, marching for, rights for people who are, undocumented, people who are from different backgrounds, whether it be the LGBT community, the Muslim community, whatnot. You know, we were marching today, and they've been marching, for lots of things. So we shouldn't just be marching about our own issues. We need to stand up for other people, other communities as well, and other forms of discrimination. And that's what we strive to do through my organization, CAIR, the Council on American Islamic Relations. We will stand up for the civil rights for all. So I think, again, trying to get to know one another, and I think one of the best ways to do it, if you just want to start out small, start through food. And we have so many great restaurants, so many great cuisines, and art. There's a lot of ways that we can communicate through our art and start with conversations. And I think through that stepping stone, we can start to build unity and get to know one another and actually advocate for each other's struggles.
I'm going to share the same sentiments. You guys were so impressive. I had a huge smile listening to each and every one of you guys. Some of you forgot your lines. I've been there myself, as an adult too. But you know what? This is such a great platform for you guys to really improve and become future leaders. So bravo to you guys and the parents who really brought them here. I think it really shows that you guys are all very involved in your kids' lives and for the betterment of it. One thing I would like to add, being a female, I wish I had seen a female panelist. And that was a question I wanted to bring up, and I hope I can, it's okay for me to say that now, is what I would like to hear and also see maybe later on is what are our male counterpart doing to really bring forth the next generation of women. And I think hearing a lot of the girls up here speak today, I think you guys are gonna be those future leaders. So keep going, keep rocking what you guys are doing. So I was really impressed. I had thrills, and just listening to you guys really made me so happy. So I'm so happy to be here, and thanks for putting this together.
I too would like to share these sentiments. I was so proud actually to listen to all the kids. When I was a kid, I used to think about how, when I had a really great idea, no one really listened to me. And as I was listening to all the kids today, I thought that I was onto something. I think we really need to listen as adults to kids and their ideas. My next point, though, is really to the parents. our children really, they take our example. And so if you don't vote, they won't be civically engaged when they hit voting age. They won't be able to speak out about things that are affecting them. So please be mindful of the fact that you are setting examples for your children too.
Thank you. I'm really proud and very happy to see the little investors of the civil rights. And I'd like to encourage you not only just take your first step, come on stage and speak to audience who you don't know. Also, when you go back to your home and your community and your school, your class, try to be that advocate. When you see anything unfair, maybe someone's being bullied, maybe you saw someone in your classroom is a little bit different, and then maybe they're kind of isolated, not having many friends, trying to be friends with them. So bring this message into your life and to start to affect our community. Thank you.
Yeah, I feel thankful to hear all this uniqueness thought. Even you are very young, or no matter you're young or old, everyone you have uniqueness. Unique thinking. So just we know we are different, right? But we also have a lot of in common. But if we just respect each other's point of view, because we have different point of view, we think we can bring the unity in the community.
Fantastic. I think I really appreciate all our judges taking the time today. So thank you. Thank you so much. And We'll be in touch, but I'm going to announce the results now. So I would like to invite Monica Goyal up here. Do we have Karishma and Deepak Chandani here by any chance? Okay. So I did want to acknowledge that we had invited many on the panelists, many locally elected women leaders. And I think Cindy Chavez was the one who accepted, and she was planning to be there, but actually something came up yesterday, so she couldn't make it. We had invited Congresswoman Anna Ashu, we had invited Zoe Lofgren. So we were trying to really balance the panel out, and unfortunately it didn't work out, but we'll keep working on it. So I did want to, Monica, please come on up here and announce the winners. And we'll start with let's do it this way. I would like to invite three people up here on stage, three of the students. And three of our contestants. And then we'll have Monica call out the winners. So let's invite Sameena Mehta up here. Let's give it up for Sameena. So we're inviting the top three winners, Ajit Chamra. And then we have Divya Balaji. All right. So the number three winner is, and I'm gonna give it to Monica to announce. The third place finish.
So the third place is Ajit Chamraj?
Yes.
Great job.
Photo opportunity, yes. Stand up. Suraj. All right, stay here. Then we have. Come on up here, Sameera and Divya. One of them is the winner, and I wonder who that is.
So much suspense. Okay, so the second place winner is Sameera Mehta.
And that's Divya, the winner. So
we all know who the first place winner is now. Great job. Kids did great job. Let's give them a big hand. So you have heard enough about Unity. I'll just close it in literally 30 seconds. Change is something that comes from within. At my age, I understand that. That comes from embracing everything that's around you. Let go of your egos. And what all the kids did up here is tremendous. It doesn't matter if you forgot your lines up here. What matters is that you have the guts to come up here and your thoughts are there. Our future is bright because you are our future. I have no doubt about it. Thank you. Have a great day.
And Monica is part of Bill Gorman's team, and we really appreciate Bill's support, and also Karishma and Deepak Chandani for making events like this happen. You know, thank you to the sponsorship. And thank you, Monica, for joining in. It's great to team up with Bill for these events. And thank you once again to the judges, to all our speakers today. I think they all did phenomenally well, very impressive. It takes a lot of courage to stand up here on stage and speak. And I give it to these very young contestants to show up here and speak their heart out. So very well done, and hopefully we'll see you all back next year. Thank you all for making this happen. Thank you.
Thank you, Rishi. Thank you.
Help with the chairs, just fold the chairs and put them up in the racks in the back.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Trustee. Happy birthday, Trami. Enjoy. On your birthday. On the birthday, she's here judging. I really appreciate it.
I expected cake this time.
Yes, absolutely.
Right. Yeah.
Sacramento on the 26th, because he's doing a special thing for the Republic Day, right?